Hello everybody, today in this video we will discuss about circular motion. There are many examples of circular motion around us in our daily life, like motion of the planets, motion of electrons around the nucleus, motion of wheel, motion of space stations, motion of moon and satellites. Now, what is circular motion? When a particle moves on the circular path with constant speed about a fixed point, that is called uniform circular motion. And for circular motion, it is not necessary that the body should complete a full circle. Even motion along arc of a circle is a circular motion. Now, to locate the position of a particle on a circular path, we measure the angle between the radius vector. As you can see from the diagram, the position of a star can be measured by the 90 degree as it moves from x-axis to y-axis along the arc. So its angular position will be 90 degree or pi by 2. If we consider this thing for a small time interval, suppose at any instant the position lie at an angular position theta I initial state. And after some time, after small time interval, it's moved to the angle theta f, final angular position. And their difference theta f minus theta I means delta theta, that is called angular displacement. And in clockwise direction, delta theta is taken as negative, and in anti-clockwise direction, delta theta is taken positive. And for one complete revolution, it has the value 360 degree or 2 pi. Now, angular displacement can be defined as the angle described by the radius vector. Means this figure shows that this OA is the initial position of the particle and OB is the final position of the particle. And the given time interval, it moves from OA to OB and make an angle theta. So this theta is called angular displacement. Now let us consider a particle is moving on the circular path of radius r, and in a small time interval it moves from position B to A and make an angle theta at the center, which is formed by the part AB, and that the length of arc is supposed to be S. Then we can relate the arc S, angle theta and radius r, which will be S is equal to r into theta. Now for a small time interval, we can write delta theta is equal to S by R, where delta theta is a ratio of two length, means it is a dimensionless ratio, but it is measured in radian. Now we will see about centripetal force. So what is the centripetal force? When a particle moves on the circular path, its speed remains constant, but direction of velocity changes continuously, hence acceleration is produced. And now from Newton's second law, there must be a force to produce an acceleration called centripetal force. So as due to change in velocity, acceleration produced directed towards the center, so this force is also directed towards the center, hence it is called centripetal force. And this force is necessary for the circular motion. Now by this diagram you can see that the particle move on the circular path. So with constant speed, its speed remains constant, but at three different positions it has different direction of velocity. So due to change in the direction of velocity, acceleration is produced, and which is directed toward the center. Hence centripetal force is also directed toward the center. So now the examples of centripetal force. In the first example, you can see that a body is tied to a string and whirled in a horizontal circle. Then centripetal force, the necessary centripetal force is provided by the tension act in the string. And as by somehow the string is broken, that body goes on tangentially. Why? Because when it was moving with the string, so the tension acting the string was providing the required centripetal force. As string is broken, the string, tension in the string becomes zero and no centripetal force is provided, hence it will not able to move on the circular path, therefore it is goes off tangentially. Which shows that the centripetal force is necessary to perform the circular motion. Now we can see the next example. Suppose a car is moving on the circular path with uniform speed. Again, centripetal force is required, but which is provided in this case by the friction force acting between the tires of the car and the road. And as these friction force acting towards the center, so they are responsible for the centripetal force required for the motion of that car on the circular track. And in another example, in the case of electrons revolving around the nucleus, again centripetal force is required, which is provided by the electrostatic force of attraction acting between the nucleus and electrons. Now centripetal force can be defined as it is the force acting on a particle performing uniform circular motion, and this force is along the radius of the circle and directed towards the center of the circle. And now we can conclude that centripetal force is that force, number one, which act on the particle performing UCM. It always act along the radius and act towards the center of the circle. Now what are the properties of centripetal force? There are many properties. Number one, this force is real force because it is a required force. Without this force, body cannot perform circular motion. And it is necessary for maintain the UCM. It act along the radius of the circle. It is directed towards the center of the circle. And centripetal force does not do any work. Why? Because it always act towards the center, and during circular motion its displacement is tangentially, which make the angle 90 degree, hence work done will be zero. And to calculate the magnitude of this force, we will use the formula F is equal to mv square by r, where m is the mass of the particle, v is the speed, and r is the radius of the circular path. Now we will discuss about the radial acceleration. Means whenever particle performs circular motion, then due to change in its velocity continuously, acceleration produced, which is always directed towards the center, as I had said earlier, that is called radial or centripetal acceleration. And this, as this acceleration is always directed towards the center, and while radius vector is directed from inside to outside, so it can be related with the A and R. A is equal to minus omega square R. This negative sign shows that this acceleration and R are directed towards in opposite direction. Now we can see the relation between the linear acceleration and angular acceleration. So we know that what is the linear acceleration? That is rate of change of velocity, means A is equal to dv over dt. And for circular motion, we also know that the relation V is equal to R omega. So as we put in the place of V, that is R omega, so it will become A is equal to d over dt of R omega, where R is the radius of the circle path, which is constant. It is taken out. Now A becomes R d omega by dt, which is equal to alpha, called angular acceleration. So now finally it becomes A is equal to R alpha. That is the relation between linear acceleration and angular acceleration. Now centrifugal force. Centrifugal force is an imaginary force. It is also called sometimes pseudo force, and it is experienced only in the non-inertial frame of reference. Means only that observer can experience this force, which will also move along with the body. And this force is necessary in order to experience the Newton's law of motion in accelerated frame of reference. Centrifugal force is act along the radius, but it is directed away from the center of the circle. That means in the opposite direction of the centripetal force. Centripetal force is always act towards the center, while centrifugal force always act away from the center. And it has the same formula as the centripetal force have, F is equal to mv square by r. It means centripetal force and centrifugal force both have the same magnitude during circular motion, but only difference is that centripetal force act towards inward while centrifugal force act towards outward, and centripetal force is a real force while centrifugal force is imaginary force, and this force is always present in the rotating bodies. Now, what are the examples of centrifugal force? Suppose when a car in motion takes a sudden turn towards left, then passengers in the car experience the outward push to the right. This is due to the centrifugal force acting on the passengers. Next example, suppose the children sitting in a merry-go-round experience an outward force as merry-go-round rotates about the vertical axis. So these are the examples of centrifugal force. And one more thing, centripetal force, we know that centripetal force act towards inward, centrifugal force act outward, but centripetal and centrifugal force do not constitute the action and reaction pair, because centrifugal force is not a real force, and for action reaction pair both the forces must be real forces. This was all about uniform circular motion. With this, I am ending this video, and thank you for joining me.